A great pleasure to be here in this very nice university. Thank you for the people in the administration, Regina and the others, for the organization, CAPES, for supporting me in this long trip from Italy to Porto Alegre. It's a pleasure. So today I will describe a research project that we are doing in Italy, my research group in the University of Pisa. And this is the title of my talk. I will present a library that we are developing. Of course, this is not a tutorial of how to use this library, but I would like to show you what are the most important research ideas that are inside. But sometimes I will also describe the API and other things of this library. Okay, it's a library in C++ for data stream processing on multicores. So we will see what is data stream processing and why we need libraries supporting multicore architectures. So first of all, before starting this talk, it's for new people that don't know me, I'm Gabriele Mencagli. Professor Luis Gustavo presented me, so I will go very fast. I studied at the University of Pisa. I'm now an assistant professor there. Okay? I belong to this research group, Parallel Programming Model Group, in my university. The group is not so large. We are actually, in this period, we are in five. Professor Marco Daneluto, who is a former visiting professor here, is our boss, then me and other colleagues. And we are involved in three main research topics. Okay? The first one is very traditional for us, is parallel programming. Then we are also involved in autonomic computing and, in the last period, data stream processing. Okay? From the parallelism perspective, because parallel computing is our main goal, okay? And we have developed different libraries and software during the years, like FastFlow, that is a library that we use to build WindFlow, that is the topic of this talk, and other libraries that I don't have time now to show you, but if you want, I can discuss with you about them. So this is just the brief outline of this talk. I will try to maintain the talk not too long, I hope. I will show what is data stream processing and what we need, why the existing tools for data stream processing are not enough. Then I will show the motivation of our work very briefly. Then I will introduce what is WindFlow. First of all, in the first part, I will show the API, but very quickly, it's not a tutorial. Then in the second part, I will show how we design the runtime system of this library. Okay, using another library that we have in our group that is called FastFlow. The two names are very similar. Okay, and then at the end, I will show some evaluation of this library, a first evaluation of this library. So first of all, the motivation. What is data stream processing? Okay, data stream processing is a very popular domain. It's a topic inside big data. Okay, you have to process a huge amount of data to extract hidden knowledge. But the very important feature of data stream processing is that such huge amount of data is not immediately available for processing. It is not a permanent data set that you have in a distributed file system, for instance. But you receive this huge volume of data from a stream. For instance, you are connected to the network. You receive, imagine financial trading application that is a popular topic of data stream processing. You have to analyze data from sensors and from the market, and you have to analyze them on the fly. Consider environmental monitoring application in which you have sensors spread in the environment, and you have to collect such huge amount of data that you receive continuously at high speed. This is the topic of data stream processing. There are many domains. Social media is a source of data streams. Okay, this is just some numbers, but not so updated, in which you can see that you have a huge number of messages or tweets per day, okay? But other topics, very popular, smart cities and autonomous driving. You have sensors in the car, a lot of sensor producing a gigabyte of data per minute, a huge amount that you have to analyze to detect dangerous situations. Or, for instance, something that we have problem in Italy like this, also in Porto Alegre a bit, I see, okay, in which you have traffic jams and you have to analyze what is the path in the street, in the city that are better. So in this case, you have also to analyze millions of events per second, a huge amount. You need proper techniques and frameworks to do that, This is why there exist many stream processing systems. Most of them are open source, so you can download and try those stream processing systems. They belong to the so-called Apache umbrella. Okay? What is the idea of these frameworks? First of all, this is the stream processing system, a general one, and what happens is that it is able to receive data from different sources, other applications, raw devices like sensor, wearable devices, or everything. And you have to, the user submit applications that are called queries. What are those queries? They are represented like a data flow graph of transformations. You have data producers, then you have intermediate transformation stages that transform the data, extract knowledge, create analytics that are transmitted to other applications, consolidated in a database. You can generate other streams for other applications and also in other storage systems. These are just a subset of existing tools that are very popular. Storm is very, very popular. But also Flink, Heron, Samza are stream processing systems belonging to the Apache umbrella. And what is a problem of those systems? One of the research challenges. Almost all those systems target distributed architectures. So the idea is to target scale-out scenarios in which you have several machines interconnected together and you scale in the performance by using multiple nodes. It's very good because you can program an application in a transparent way with respect to the hardware. You don't know that part of your graph, if you remember, is distributed, okay? This is good, but to do that, this is just the idea of scale out, they use the Java virtual machine. So the API and the runtime system are written in Java in almost all the frameworks that I mentioned in the previous slide. And this is good because, of course, the JVM provides a good abstraction and portability, helps in reducing the effort for data serialization and deserialization, but add some extra overhead, okay? Like virtual function, garbage collector. And some colleagues in the past demonstrated a very important point, that the achieved performance of those frameworks is far from the physical limit of the single machine. What happened? This is just a plot taken from a very important paper published in a top conference this year. And you can see that if you, for a benchmark, if you measure the throughput of the application of three frameworks, Flink, Spark Streaming, and Storm, compared with the memory bandwidth of one single multicore, you are very far from that. The problem is that nowadays, you have modern servers, single machine shared memory with several cores inside, several coprocessors like GPUs, okay? Terabytes of memory. In many cases, those systems, single nodes, are more than enough for executing in a very efficient way application. And there is no need to go in a distributed system. So what happens is that if you want to exploit at best the resources provided by a single machine, the existing tools are not so efficient because they target distributed architectures. So we need to introduce new systems that target scale-up scenarios, so single machines in a quite efficient way. But this needs to completely redesign the runtime system. And this is what we did with our library, okay? Trying to fill this gap. Actually, there are other prototypes for single machines, but no consolidated solution exists nowadays for stream processing on single machine. So this is a still open research issue, okay? Okay, this is what I will explain today. WindFlow, you can download this library from GitHub. There is also a web page with a tutorial of how to use the library. It's an ongoing research, so we are still improving the library step by step. First of all, the software layers of this library. This library, this is more or less the architecture. You have application, you have our WindFlow, the topic of this lecture, of this talk, sorry. And then this library is built on top of FastFlow, that is another library but lower level for parallel processing on multicores that we developed at the University of Pisa. In particular of this library, we use the so-called building blocks. Building blocks are like Lego bricks that we know from our childhood, okay? You can compose Lego bricks to build complex things. And this is more or less the same idea that I will try to explain later, okay? And this is what we have, and our goal is to obtain higher throughput and lower latency than existing solution, okay? But also to show that we need something different than the existing solutions on single machines to improve performance. So how can we develop a WindFlow application? This is something that is common to the other frameworks, okay? How we can develop a stream processing application in general? You build a data flow graph of operators. Operators are the vertices that perform data transformation. Such data transformation is developed by the user. So the idea is that suppose that you have this graph, it's your application. This one is the source in some way able to generate the stream because it is connected to a network, to a socket, or from a database, okay? Any source. And you define the code of this source by creating a class that extends other classes of the library with the code for generating the data. You can, of course, instantiate operators, connecting them. This is another operator, another class, with the code that should be executed every time you have one message to produce results. Of course, you have to connect the operators together. So you can imagine this is not the real syntax. This is just a simplification, okay? You create the application, you add the source, you add the first operator. You can add other operators. In this case, just to mention, operator 2 suppose that it is replicable in two different instances to increase the performance. Instead, operator 3 is replicated 3 times to increase the performance. Of course, such kind of replication is possible if specific constraints are satisfied. If the transformation is stateless, no problem, you can replicate. If the transformation is stateful, you can replicate sometimes, and a very popular situation is when the state can be partitionable. So the idea is that you have a state, red, blue, yellow, there, and you do the scheduling of the data in such a way that all the data items modifying this partition will be delivered to this one. Okay? But there are other paradigms for parallelizing stateful operators that need to maintain a history of what they see so far. Okay, so we can have parallel regions in the data flow graph. So now, how can we use our library to do that? So this is just a short overview of the API, but I will go fast for this. The API is in C++, especially we use C++ 17. And first of all, this is the list of operators that we have. We have a source node that can generate data according to the user, the business logic code provided by the user. And the idea is that the source generate data of the same type, okay, T in this case. Then we have other operators. For instance, the map operator apply a one-to-one transformation. What is the idea? You receive one message, an input, and for each input, you produce exactly one output. Otherwise, you have a filter. In the filter case, you receive one input and you decide whether that input should be delivered outside or drop it away, out, okay? So you reduce the volume of input. You have flat map, in which you receive one input and you can generate 0, 1, or several outputs. Very general situation. Other operators like the accumulator are not important, I will show later. We have other operators. This is very important. I don't know if you can see there just as a reference this figure. In many cases in stream processing application, you receive a huge amount of data. But what happens is that the last data items that you receive are much more important than the oldest one. Consider a financial trading application. The last transactions that you are receiving are very important for your analytics. So what happens is that in many cases, since the stream is unbounded and you cannot keep a whole history of what you see, because otherwise, sooner or later, your memory will explode, you have a limited window of what is interesting. And you compute every time this window is full. And then when you receive other things, other elements, the oldest one, will be removed. So this is a popular paradigm of stream processing, sliding windows, that have a huge set of different semantics. They can be temporal, like applying a transformation in the items received in the last 1 minute, or count in the last 1,000 elements, or more complex semantics. We provided operators for doing such kind of transformation. I don't want to enter into detail because we will see later, but just to understand there are parallelization in which you can apply the processing on windows of different streams, or you can parallelize the processing of different windows, or inside the window you can parallelize. There are many operators to do that. And then there is the sync operator, where you receive a stream of data and you consolidate those results, for instance, writing in a database, delivering them to another application, and so forth. So just to understand what is the idea for creating operators or patterns, they are the same term in our library. Okay? How can we create those operators? The idea is to use a builder object to build a specific operator and to configure the specific properties of the operator. This is just the idea. Suppose that we want to generate, to create a generic operator or pattern, this one with the name. This operator receives a stream of messages of type T1, generate a stream of messages of type T2, this is a template, and you create this pattern with a builder in which you provide a function. What is this function? Not defined here. This function is the logic code, the business logic code, that in this case is executed every time you receive a message of type T1 to produce a message of type T2. This is something that the user define and provide to this builder object. And you can choose some configuration parameters of this operator. We will see this notation with dot is a fluent interface that is very popular. Okay, what we can do using C++ 17 is to use some feature of the language in order to simplify the creation of the operators. For instance, in this case, using C++ 17, it is not necessary to specify the template arguments because we can, the compiler, automatically deduce the type of the pattern, in this case T1 and T2, from the signature of the function f that you provide. So you don't have to specify any template argument, and this simplifies a lot the writing of the code. And this is what we did. Of course, you can do that for all the patterns. I will show some examples. Just a few examples, not all the operators, okay? I will just two of them, maybe. How can we instantiate a source? To instantiate a source, the idea is to, we can use different functions. Consider this. The second one, for simplicity, you have to create a function returning nothing, but in which you have this special object given by the runtime system that you can use for sending data items of type tuple T. So this is just the idea of this function. In this case, we create the function as a functor object. What is a functor object? It's an object that you can use as a function, okay? So in this case, very simple idea, we generate 10,000 messages, delivering each message every 1 millisecond, because there is a slip there. Just a very stupid example. This is a source, of course, generating random values, okay? But you can put there a code reading from a socket, reading from somewhere, okay? And then we create the source using the builder, providing this object as the function. So the template arguments are deduced by this signature. And then you specify a name for the operator. You specify also parallelism. For instance, suppose that you have two replicas of this source doing exactly the same behavior. So parallelism two. And you build the object. OK? Another example, and then stop with the API. For instance, the map. In the map case, we can use different functions supposed to use. In this case, I don't remember, yes, the first function is you receive a message, you modify this message, and you deliver it outside. So you are modifying the message in place, right? So you can instantiate, in this case, the code. In this case, it's very stupid because we suppose that the input message is a record with a field volume that is an integer, and we double the value. Very stupid, okay? This is the code written by the user, and then you can create the operator in a very nice way. You give the operator function. Then you specify a parallelism. Also in this case, this is completely stateless, so you can replicate. And then you build the object. Of course, there are other, but I will skip, filter in which you have a predicate, returning true or false if you want to drop or not the item, and other things, the flat map, in which you have a shipper object that can be used for sending multiple results. Because remember, in the flat map, you receive one message and you can generate zero, one, or multiple results. So you can push the result in the shipper object. Okay, the sync. Just to mention that in the sync, we use a special object given by C++ in the last standard that is an optional. What is an optional? An optional is a special object that contains a reference to a data type. But the idea is that if you use pointers in C++, if you can say a pointer is null, it is not meaningful. Otherwise, it is something that is useful. For the reference, with the optional is the same. You can use the optional as an expression. If it is true, the reference is meaningful. If it is false, it is not meaningful. So you can write the code of the sync in a very simple way, because in this case, if the object that you receive is meaningful, there is a new data. If it is not meaningful, it means that the stream is over. So the application is complete, because sooner or later, our stream processing application that is long running, sooner or later should be complete. Okay? I'd like to spend just 1 minute for window operators, the one in which you have the history. We can express parallelism in different ways that is not possible in other frameworks. In most of the frameworks, you can express parallelism of windows of different streams. What is the idea? Consider, just to be very simple, a financial trading application in which you receive a stream of transactions. You can distinguish transaction based on a specific attribute. You have transaction of a specific stock symbol, like Apple, transactions of another company, and you group them, and you apply separate windows, and you can go in parallel between windows of those groups. This is something that exists in all the frameworks. But we can do other parallelism ideas, like parallelizing the same stream, different windows of the same stream. Consider here that we have, for simplicity, a window of size 6, sliding every 2. We can parallelize and execute in parallel windows that are ready of the same stream, provided that the replicas, the different threads, will receive the right values. We can also parallelize inside the windows. I will show in a while. And we have different processing functions. For instance, you can execute the computation on a window when the window is full. So you have the window, now it's full, I trigger the processing. Or you can do something smarter. Instead of waiting the completion of the window, you can update the result of the window as soon as you receive new item that belong to it. This is an incremental processing. Both are supported by the library. This is just the pattern for executing in parallel windows of different stream, in which you provide the function, in this case to compute the average of the items in the window, very stupid, or and in this case, you create the pattern. There are other patterns. Just to mention what is this one, between windows, you have overlapping, right? So in this case, in the previous idea, you compute windows from scratch. But you could try to use the overlapping to reduce the computation. This is what we can do with this pattern. This is just the graphical idea. If you have windows of size 6 sliding every 2 items, you can compute intermediate results of 2 items and reuse them to avoid recomputing the windows from scratch. When you pass from these windows to this window, the 2 intermediate results of these 2 are in common. And this is what is possible with this pattern, in which you have the function for computing the intermediate results and for aggregating them, and then you create the pattern. I will skip the API, but it's important that you understand the idea. OK, so I'm in time to introduce this nice part. How can we build the runtime system? So this is the API. If you are a user of this library, you will use this API. You don't know what happened inside. Now, since this is a research talk, we will see how we build the runtime system. And the runtime system is based on fast flow building blocks. So just a few words about fast flow. it's necessary to give the credits, okay, to my friends. Okay, FastFlow has a long history. It was developed, the first release was in 2009. So we published more than, not only me, 100 research papers about FastFlow. It was used in different research projects, European research projects. So this is a quite stable library. And in particular, we can build application in FastFlow. Applications are graph of nodes, where each node is one thread in the architecture. And nodes are interconnected with each other. How? The idea is that when you have to send a message to someone, since we are in a shared memory system, I don't copy the message in a buffer of the destination, but I send only the pointer. So I give to the destination the possibility to read the data that is shared between threads. Not difficult idea, it is reference passing, we can say, or pointer passing. And this is what happens when you compose these nodes in a data flow graph. But in FastFlow, you can use, okay, building blocks to do that. What are those building blocks? Of course, the basic building block is a standard node. One input stream, one output stream, okay? Or you can have multiple input node. You can several input stream arriving at the node, at the thread, and you produce one output stream of pointers, okay? You can have multiple output node, the opposite. You receive one stream of references and you produce many output channels. And then we have this very important new building block. What is? Remember that in FastFlow, one node is one thread, right? So if you have a very large graph, you have a lot of threads. So what you can do is to merge two different nodes that are connected with each other in one single thread that execute them sequentially. This is the combiner. So you are creating a new node combining two nodes. And of course, you can reiterate this in order to combine 3, 4, 5, 6 nodes, okay? Of course, I said that there are, we send pointers. There are efficient lock-free queues to send pointers between different nodes without doing any atomic lock or unlock. There are a huge literature about this, okay? We can do this very efficiently with few hundred of nanoseconds on commodity machine to send one pointer from one thread to another one. Okay, this is just the example of a FastFlow node, but I can skip. This is the combiner. If you want, at the end, I will give you details. But now it's better to go fast in this. What are parallel building blocks? Because so far we see sequential building blocks, nodes and combiner. What are the parallel building blocks? The first one is the farm. I will mention pipeline later. Farm is a building block where you can when you have an array of building blocks that could be equal with each other or different, and you have a sequential node in charge of distributing the messages in a balanced way, hopefully, to the building blocks that you have on the right side. But this is a more powerful building block. It is called all-to-all. The idea is to have, on the left side, an array of building blocks that could be sequential or parallel, okay? Because you can nest, you can have a farm there, okay? And on the right side, you have another array of building blocks. They are interconnected with a shuffled pattern. So all the building blocks on the left are connected with all the building blocks on the right. This is another Lego brick. And of course, you have pipeline in which you can put building blocks, sequential or parallel, in pipeline connecting the first one to the second one, the third, the second one with the third, and so on, okay? Please observe that all those building blocks can be nested together. You can have there an all-to-all, a farm. You could have, if it is reasonable, a farm with inside these all-to-all and a nesting that you want. So how can we use those building blocks for our purpose of the WindFlow library? An application in WindFlow is expressed using this notion of multi-pipe. So you, in the previous API, I mentioned how to create the operators, right? But the operators are not interconnected together. You create the source, the first one, the second one, the filter, the map. Now you have to put them together in the right order. To do that, you use a multipipe. But what is a multipipe? A multipipe is something like that. Suppose that you have a source with two replicas. Another operator A, generic one, with two replicas, B, three replicas, C, two replicas, and then the sync, two replicas. They are interconnected in this way for the application semantics. So what is the idea? Is that you have a pipeline, many pipelines, but sometimes you have a pipeline that jump to another side. Okay? How can we build this with the building block of FastFlow? Please observe that there are some cases in which you have direct connection, cases in which you have a shuffled pattern. Why you can need this? Suppose that this one is configured in such a way that this replica receives all the transactions with K Apple. Since those transactions can be generated by the two replicas there, you need to have an all-to-all pattern. This is why you could have something like that. But how can we build this with the building blocks of FastFlow? And this is just a joke, because the idea is to use something like that. Okay? The Chinese boxes, or matryoshka if you like, that, okay, is to nest the things together in a very nice way. What is a matryoshka? A matryoshka is a old tool where you have on the left n pipeline nodes, n pipelines on the left, and you have on the right side one pipeline. And this is the idea. This is a matryoshka. A old tool, now there is no connection, the connection is in this way, okay? You have many pipeline there, one pipeline on the right. And what happens if I have to nest? I nest on this part. You understand? So matryoshka nesting is in the right set of the old tool. Okay? How can we use that? Consider that we want to create our application and that we start with an empty multipipe. The first thing that you have to add to the multipipe is the source, because you have to generate data, okay? So we add a source. Suppose that we create a source with parallelism 2, and we add this source to the pipe, multipipe. We create a multipipe instance and we add the source, okay? At the beginning, the multipipe is empty, so we create the first matryoshka there, in which we put the two sources on the right set. This one is empty. Now, we add, suppose, a map or a filter or a flat map. And suppose that the parallelism is the same, too. No need to create another matryoshka. The parallelism is the same. So we add the two replicas, in this case of a map, in the left side, connecting them in pipeline. Okay? But what could happen if the parallelism is different? For instance, we want to add a filter operator with parallelism 3. What is the idea? Please observe. From our point of view, the filter is something like that. You have the filter, and you have a sort of emitter that is a node in charge of performing the distribution of data to the filters. This distribution for the filter is very trivial, but could be complex for other operators. The concept is the same. So what is the idea? We have our multipipe, we add this filter, 3 is the parallelism degree, different than 2. We add a new matryoshka. And what happens is that we combine this scheduling logic of the operator with the replicas. This is sequential combination. Do you remember the building block combiner? This is one thread. And this is what happened. Of course, we have also to combine something there. Why? Because this instance, that is single input, single output, could receive actually data from several sources, so you have to combine it with a multi-input node that could perform some complex actions like ordering. Another building block, the combiner, okay? And this is what happened. Suppose another very interesting thing, but what happens if I have a lot of threads? Sometimes it is possible to combine operators together if the specific rules are satisfied. For instance, if we are adding to the multipipe a map, a filter, a flat map, or a sync, without the need of split by k, and if the number of replicas of this pattern is the same of the previous one in the multipipe, you can chain them. Example, we create a flat map with parallelism tree, and instead of add, we chain. What happens is that the flat map, instead of creating an arrow between them, they are chained. It could be useful to reduce the number of threads. You understand this? The general idea? Okay, so this is what happened. Of course, we can add complex operators, like, for instance, we can add an operator working on sliding windows. In this case, you are always forced to create a new matryoshka because you split by k. Okay, but it's the same, the idea. Okay, and now we can do something smarter. But what happens if I have an application in which I have several sources producing data of different types? Because I have one source reading from a database and another source reading from the network. And I have to elaborate those data and join them. It's a problem. In that case, what we can do is the union of multipipes. What happens is that, suppose that we create a first multipipe that is not complete. You cannot run it because there is no sync. So you create this one with two sources and three instances of a filter. Okay? Then you create another multipipe with other sources producing data of different type, three in this case, and then a flat map. Now, we can try to unify them if what? These two sources produce data of type yellow. These two sources produce data of type green. But to be joined together, the output should be the same as the type. The type should be the same, otherwise you cannot join them. So what happens is that we create, we have to, before doing the union, you have to change a little bit the shape of the two matryoshka. How? It's difficult to explain in English, but the figure is very simple. You have to remove this one, put these two that are in the left set of the innermost matryoshka in the right set of the previous one. So you finalize the two hole to hole, and then you can join together creating a new matryoshka like this, ready to add other things on the end. You understand the idea? Now you can add other operators connected to this, because the type is the same. Are you following me, more or less? Okay? So, then you can run the application, because we did this, we created the operators, we interconnect them, and now we have to run the application. To run the application, very easy. Suppose that the application is something like this, because we added the sync, in this case chained, but it could be also a all-to-all there or other situation. And then you have to, in this case, how many nodes we have. If you count the number of fast flow nodes, you have 24 nodes. But how many threads do you have? In this case, only 9, if you count them. This is one thread. Very long pipeline, but executed sequentially by one thread. So we can run this application how? You have the pipe, you chain it, the sync, the last step, and then you run and wait end. What is the idea? Simply that you are running the application in a synchronous way. You are the main thread, run the application, and wait that the application is complete. So all these three elements are processed. Otherwise, you can do that asynchronously, in which you start the application, and then the main thread can do something else. Okay? So to conclude, we have to see some first results. Okay? Please observe that, of course, we are sure that our system is better than the existing one. Why? But not because the existing one has fault tolerance, target distributed system. So for sure, they have a huge overhead. But we want to understand, by completely redesigning the system for a single machine, what could be the advantage, the gain in terms of performance. Okay. So we tried different applications, four applications in this case, using other papers. Okay, this is more or less the idea of the application. The first one is a fraud detection application in which you analyze the transaction of credit cards and you detect something wrong. You use, in this case, it is a pipeline of three operators with the middle one that is the bottleneck, performing stochastic models based on Markov chains to detect something wrong. The second application is spike detection, is an application for environmental monitoring in which you receive a large set of measurements, you compute windows, and then you detect if some values are outlier, very far from the mean. Okay? You have traffic monitoring is an application that analyzes the data generated by taxi drivers in the city of Beijing in China. And also in this case, you detect the average speed in the different roads of the city. And the last one is the Yahoo streaming benchmark, very popular if you Google it, in which you have to analyze data of advertisement campaigns to detect statistics. They are pipeline of operators, in this case, not complex graphs. We will do in the future the evaluation of more complex application in terms of the structure of the operators. They are not complex in terms of computation performed, but not in terms of interconnection. And this is the implementation in WindFlow. But please observe that it is just the straightforward implementation. All the operators could have a parallelism, and so the interconnection is very complex. Okay? And this is what we use for building those applications. And this is just a very brief overview of the throughput. I don't enter in the detail. If you want, we can discuss later. Okay? But we measured the peak throughput provided with the best parallelism for the different applications. So we selected for each operator the best parallelism. We tried in an exhaustive way all the configuration, and then we pick the best one. We did the same with other frameworks, Flink and Storm. Okay? In our case, in all the cases, we use a single machine. In this case, it is not so large. It is a multi-core machine with 16 cores with 32 hyper-threaded context. And this is what we have. Okay, this is for the different application: fraud detection, spy detection, traffic monitoring, Yahoo streaming benchmark. This is the throughput with Flink, Storm, WindFlow, and WindFlow with chaining. Because you can, when you can chain operator or not. We tried chaining operators or not. Okay? As you can see, we have a very large, between Flink and Storm, there are situations in which Storm is better, situation in which instead Flink is better. This depends on the frameworks and on the applications. They are very different. But what is good is that our system is very fast. Of course, I insist, we know this because the language is different, the runtime system is different, but we wanted to analyze how better is our implementation. So this is more or less what we achieve. In some cases, the advantage is very large, and this happens especially in very fine-grained applications. Because, of course, the synchronization overhead now is very huge, and the difference between runtime system is important. In application in which you have operators that are very, very, very slow, of course, there is the difference between the JVM and C++ that we know. C++ is faster, but, of course, the impact of the runtime system is less important. Okay? But in most cases, the advantage is significant. Other important thing: in many companies, because this is why we are trying to not sell, to advertise our library to companies in Italy, it's latency reduction, not only throughput, but latency reduction. Because sometimes people working in company and dealing with stream processing have the problem that their application are, okay, the throughput is okay with Storm or Flink, but the latency is very, very high. But I have one single machine, one very powerful. I would like to reduce this latency. So just to mention and to reduce the slides, an evaluation for the last application, the Yahoo streaming benchmark. Okay, in this case, what happened is that we compare between WindFlow and Flink because Storm is very, very high to the latency. Okay, instead, Flink, in many, if you Google something about Flink, you discover that Flink is advertised as also a good framework for single machine, but not actually, not too much, okay? As you can see, this is just the latency that we measure with a box plot. If we change the number of threads of the application, and what we can see is that in both cases, if we add more parallelism, of course you have more overhead of scheduling, and the latency is a little bit higher. But what happened is that the times, the scale there is very different. Please observe that we have millisecond, but here the average is in the order of few milliseconds of latency. There it is 100 of milliseconds due to the overhead of JVM that we always pay using traditional systems. So if you have the necessity to program fast stream processing application with a very user-friendly interface in a single machine, C++ is a good alternative. And our system behaves very well. could be a good solution if you target single machines, for which, I repeat, no existing solution is a de facto standard nowadays. Of course, there are other prototypes. We will compare against them, but it's another topic. Okay? We can conclude. If you want to try the library, this is just the website. Not too long. We have to add materials there, but you can see the essential things there. If you download the code, we are still improving the library with the documentation. There is the DocsyGen, but you can use them. As you can see, this is a good library in terms of programming, but there is also a nice research idea behind to develop in a very modular way the runtime system. Of course, there are still many things that we have to do, like making our graph a little bit more generic, but we are still working on it. This is what we have now, and I hope that you enjoyed this talk, and if you have questions, I'm here for trying to answer. Okay? Tell me something.
Thank you for it. It was a nice presentation, and I think it's a very elegant and powerful API.
Yeah.
Really, really good, and some really nice ideas. But one thing that I'm always concerned about when we are thinking about this kind of APIs and this kind of system for improving the programmability is that even with this kind of solution, which is very, very nice, in my opinion, and very advanced for what I've
seen
so far.
Thank you.
I'm always think that we are still really far from a higher level of abstraction that could be very interesting for make it more popular.
Yeah.
And more because big data and data streaming is really exploding now. Everybody wants to use that, and many companies. And so far, we are... I'm always thinking that we are still a little bit far from a really
high level. Oh, thank you.
What are your thoughts about that?
I think that you are perfectly right in the sense that our API try to, in some way, be very similar to the ones existing with the other frameworks. If you program with Flink and Storm, the API is more or less at the same level of abstraction. So we tried to give something that the user should know, because there are many people working in Storm, Flink. But in general, I perfectly agree that this API is not sufficiently high level. But there are other frameworks that try to provide a high-level API. For instance, there are frameworks that provide, not so popular, research projects that provide a declarative language to describe the graph using a sort of SQL, very close to databases. But what happened in that case? Very nice, but the generality is not too much. So there is always a trade-off between high-level abstractions and the possibility to customize a little bit the code. And this is a very critical problem of the research. Try to understand which kind of abstractions provide a good high-level view, but with possibility knobs that can be configured. This is something that we have to think about. It's a very, very hot topic and very complex, very complex. Very complex. If the domain is very specific, if you think about very specific application, you can do that. But maybe the tool becomes very constrained to that specific topic. But this is something that we have to think about.
You are thinking about to add fault tolerance support.
For a single machine, sometimes could be useful. Yeah. We could try to do that. Try to use external permanent storage where you can recover. This is something that we can do, of course. Depends on the problem is the effort needed and the people working on it.
Yes, for example, take a photo of for that memory.
Yeah, I know. We have to do that.
But you think to do that?
It's in the plan sooner or later. Especially, our goal is not to sell the product, okay? We are from university, our goal is research. Of course, we are very happy if people try to work on the library and then suggest something, because maybe could start a small community working on it. This is the idea, okay? Because we cannot do all the things we are in five. You remember the group. But the idea is that if someone, we have collaboration with companies, maybe we can start something here. okay, also.
It was very nice. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.